them themselves and vow for yourselves. While they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they were ready, went in with him into the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgin, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily, I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. You may be seated.
To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away. I have read in your hearing Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 1 through 6. May the Lord add a blessing to his holy word.
Amen. Amen.
A New Testament reading, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13, it says, But I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, so, and also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. But this we say unto thee, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord should not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall ascend from heaven with a great shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Verse 18, Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. And we read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. May the Lord have a blessing to the reader here on his word. May the Lord bless his family during this time.
Most gracious Father in heaven, we come to you, Lord, this morning and
submission unto you. Lord, we come thanking you for this day. Lord, you didn't have to wake us up this morning, but you saw fit to let us see another day.
Yes.
And Lord, we come before you this morning just asking that you would strengthen this family. Dear Lord, that you would just lift them up on every leaning side. You would strengthen them where they're weak and build them up where they're torn down. Comfort them, Father, and let them know that you understand their pain. You know what they're going through and that you care. Now, Lord, we all have to face this day. We all want to have to come before you and give account of what we've done in this body. We all have to face the judgment seat of Christ. And then, Lord, I pray that they know you in the point of their sin, and that they have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Now, be with them, Father. We know that days are going to come and pain is going to continue to be there. But I pray, oh Lord, that you would just give them peace. Be with Tamiko. Be with her children. Be with the family as a whole.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, only you can comfort. Lord, we don't always understand everything that you do. But we know that you care for us.
Yes.
We know that you have bring us not this far to leave us. You said in your word that you never leave us nor would you forsake us. So I pray, Lord, that you would just let them know that you understand. And then, Lord, let them reflect back on the days that they have had with their mother and their grandmother. Let them realize, oh Father, that you will be with them. Help them to remember the good days.
Yes.
Father, we all have lost loved ones. So, Father, all of us have been here. We know that there are going to be days that they're going to cry. But you said in your word to wipe away every tear. So I pray that you would just wipe away their tears and help them to find joy in the midst of sorrow. We love you, Father. We thank you for your Son who died on the cross for our sins.
Yes,
Lord. And then, Lord, we know that he rose on the third day, that we might have life, eternal life. Thank you, Lord. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Straight to fire. have the moment that be able to offer encouragement to this family. So if it's time, if people would like to make a remark or have encouraging word for this family, we invite you to come up and just please adhere to the 2 minutes that's been put in the program. So if we have some, if you just line up, let's call. What we normally do, we, our local church is no more than 5 because we do have a limit in this chapel. So if we can have those who wish to say a remark, if you line up on this wall, they yield the program, the podium to you. Amen. We have 2. Amen. Thank God. Thank you, God.
To the officiating pastor, to all of my co-laborers in the gospel, but most of all to this great family. And I am Pastor Ernest L. Zachary Sr. of Highway to Heaven, Missionary Baptist Church at Denley Drive and Stella Avenue. I'm here on behalf of Sister Tamika William. She's a co-worker of mine at Avis Rum Car at Love Fever. Not only that, a few years ago in the early 2000s, I had the privilege of joining her and her husband together in holy matrimony. Tamika, I just want to let you know today I love you. But the Bible said to be absent from the body.
Yes.
Is to be present with the Lord. I believe Revelation 14 and 13 says, right, blessed is the day that died in the Lord. Henceforth, said the Spirit, they shall rest from their labor, and their work do follow them. May God continue to bless you. If you need me, give a call. My number has not changed. God bless you today.
Words of remarks. Now we have a selection
He watches for me. I see
the darkness. Take this mask off.
I am fully vaccinated, but I do respect the airspace of others. So if you would allow me to do this, I might be in water here, thirsty. Amen. Let's pray. Dear God, Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you, dear Lord, for this season, recognizing, dear Lord, that none of us planned this day. We didn't plan it definitely to be here, but we know, dear Lord, that you know all things. Do all things well. So now we pray that you might speak comfort to this family. They might hear from you on today. They might be blessed by the service. That they might continue to live a life that's pleasing in thy sight. Help them, the Lord, to think of the good things of Williams. Help them, the Lord, to try to do their best to be a model not just for this family, but for all those who come in contact with. Bless now, keep now. It's in the blessed, powerful name of Jesus, we pray and we ask it all. Amen.
Amen.
Had to put that pepper in my mouth because I was getting dry. Just for thought on today, I'm going to be looking at, you just see, it's from 1 Peter 5 and 7. Just one verse. I'm going to hold you long. 1 Peter 5 and 7 simply says to casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you.
Amen.
Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Just for a thought subject on this morning, I want to talk from the subject, he cares. He cares. The question that has been asked over and over again by believers and non-believers, does God know, and does God really care?
Yes.
Does God really care about me? Does God really care about my problems, my troubles, and my tribulations? Thank you. And does God care how I feel at this present time?
Yes.
And is he really interested in what I'm going through? For some, the answer that question may very well be resounding no. For some, it's quite possible that it just might be a maybe. And then for others, it might easily be an exuberant yes. Yes, God really cares about me. The Bible reveals to us that ongoing question that plagued Job in Old Testament book. You may know the story that Job was a righteous man, a just man, a wealthy man that eschewed evil. Yet Job lost all of his children at once in a storm. Job had a lightning strike that killed all of his animals. Job had enemies that stole all the rest of his animals. And to add insult to injury, his enemies killed all of his hired servants. Yet in his misery and in his disappointments, Job believed in God, but that did not stop him from questioning God and asking that age-old question, does God really care about me and what I'm going through right now? And I believe there might be one or two in here with that same question, that same type of attitude, and with that very same thing on your mind. But this one verse in 1 Peter 5 and 7, it reminds us and reveals to us that God really cares about us.
Yes.
It may not seem like it right now, but for 78 years, God gave Sister Claudia Williams life. 78 years he kept her. 78 he protected her. He provided for her. He cared for her. And that we ought to all be thankful and eternally grateful for her life. Sadly, there's nothing I can say or do to bring Sister Williams back. But God's will has been done. But hopefully I can provide some comfort, some strength, and some encouragement to this family in the midst of their grief and in the midst of their pain. I can't preach Miss Claudia's eulogy. In fact, my pastor, Dr. A.E. Sharp, has constantly reminded us that we preach our own eulogy,
by the way we live and the impact that we have on others.
Yes.
And so we want this life and the life and love of Sister Williams to live on. And we ought to do our part by living a life that's pleasing to God and pleasant to all we encounter. I may not know or understand the kind of state you're in right now, nor the anxieties you are experiencing. And my only suggestion right now is for you to trust God and turn all your cares and concerns unto Him, for God careth for you. And that's what I believe this text is reminding us. And if you would, I won't be long. Allow me to share with you three quick insights that I see coming from this text. And then we'll be under the direction of the Evergreen staff. But the first thing that I see I want to share with you this morning is I see the dreary situation. This word dreary means to feel listless, discouraged, gloomy, dismal, having nothing to provide cheer or comfort. Those things or situations that can be classified as dreary are more bills than you have money, a terminal illness, a hopeless situation, and even death. But I say, I know it's easier said than done, but I say unto you, to cast or to turn all those matters over to God and allow Him to help you through. The text says to cast all of your cares. The word cast simply means to give. Now, I don't know how many fishermen I have in here, but I can tell you that if I hit my rod and reel, I could literally put it in my hand, cast it, and hit that back wall. Literally out of my reach. Now to send it that far, to cast it that far, would to be extended beyond my reach. Well, that's what God wants you to do with your cares. God wants us to cast our problems, our pains, our situations, our sorrows as far away as we can and as close as we can unto Him. So whatever it is that's hurting or hindering you right now, you need to round back and give it a great big old heave. Send it as far and as fast and as quickly as you can unto the direction of the Lord. The Lord is a waiting recipient. He's a waiting recipient of our every grief, our every concern, and our every sorrow. And He's a recipient of our loneliness, our emptiness, and our despair. Secondly, not only do I see the dreary situation, I also see the direct source. And all of this is found in verse number 7. For the text reminds us that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is our every need. In fact, the Bible says in Psalms 46 and 1, that He is a very present help in times of trouble.
Yes, He is.
Those troubles can be disease, it can be destruction, it can be divorce, it can be disappointment, and it can even be death. Whatever we have, or whatever it is that's hindering us, we can turn it over to the source who can handle our every situation, our every problem, and that source is Jesus. In fact, Jesus reminds us in Matthew 11, 28 through 30, to come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul, for my yoke is easy. And my burden is light.
Yes.
All right.
Jesus is and always should be our main source. Yes. Whenever we are dealing with a heavy load or experiencing a dreary situation.
All right.
The reason I say that because there will come a time, if it haven't already, when our mothers can't help us.
Yes.
When our daddies can't help us.
Oh.
When your family and your friends can't help us.
Yes.
There'll come a time when even your money, your degrees, your influence won't be able to help you.
Yes, sir.
The only one who truly will be able to help you is Jesus the Christ, who's our direct source and our Heavenly Father.
Yeah.
No wonder why the songwriter wrote that there is no secret what God can do.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. What he's done with others, he can do the same for you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This text reminds us that our direct source, our deliverer, our dedicated Savior, he hears our every cry, our every call, and he's always available for our every need.
Yes, he is.
And the fact of the matter is, in order for us to even talk to our Heavenly Father, we need to develop a relationship with him, communicate, voice our concerns, and give all of our cares to Jesus, for Jesus cares for us.
Yes.
That's how valuable and precious and important Jesus is. That no matter what our cares are, our first inclination ought to be and should be directed to Jesus. For Jesus has the answer to all of our problems.
Yes, he does.
We don't have to be bashful about it. We don't have to be ashamed about it. We don't really have to be concerned about it.
Right.
The only thing we need to do is to give it to Jesus and let him direct our lives and handle our dreary situation.
Yeah.
This text reminds us that God knows what we stand in need of.
That's right.
When we need it. And so he sent his son, our direct source, to help us. And his name is Jesus.
Yeah.
Finally, not only do I see the dreary situation and the direct source, I want to close with the divine sentiment. The text says once again that we need to cast all of our cares unto him, for he cares for you.
Yes.
This text is a short, yet broad, universal statement. For it ends with the word you. And the bottom line is it simply relays the fact that God really cares about us as individuals.
Yeah.
Growing up, many of us used to always say in a playful manner, it's just me, myself, and I.
Uh-huh.
But in relation to this text, you can literally say that Jesus, our Lord and Savior, cares about me, myself, and I.
Right.
Jesus loves us. He cares for every last one of us. And he wants us to know that we are special to him and to our Heavenly Father.
Yes.
That's why the reason that Jesus died on Calvary's cross, in order that we might have the right to the tree of life. The reason is because he cares for us.
Yeah.
That's why Jesus reminded us that he went to prepare a place for us. And where he is, there we may be also.
Yes.
That's for the believers. And the reason is because he cares for us.
Yeah.
This text lets us know that Jesus has divine sentiment in regards to our specific needs. And the reason for that is Jesus knows that your needs are not my needs. He knows your desires are not my desires. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. Your cares and concerns are not mine, and your sorrows are not mine as well. Because we all grieve and we all sorrow a little different.
Yes.
Jesus knows what you're going through right now. He knows your situation is not like my situation. Because we all have our own set of issues.
Yes.
Our own set of problems, our own set of tribulations, in our own way of grieving.
Yes.
Yet the good thing about Jesus, he never gets us confused.
Yes.
He will never get us crossed up or mixed up with one another. Because Jesus knows us individually.
Yes,
he does. We are unique, and our wants and our needs are unique as well. And Jesus has everything we stand in need of. And those things are specifically and individually designed for us. And that's our divine sentiment. So whatever emotion of grief you're experiencing right now, my encouragement is to let it go. To give it all to Jesus.
Yes.
For he cares for you.
Yeah.
So let me close by trying to give you encouragement by reminding you to tell Jesus all about it.
Yeah.
To trust Jesus.
Yes.
To try Jesus. Yes. Not just today, but always.
Right.
When the family has left, when the phone calls have stopped, the cards have quit arriving in the mail, and when you find yourself all alone, trust Jesus.
Yes.
For it's Jesus who can help you. Jesus alone.
Yes.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. For in my distress, he kindly will help me. For he helped, loves, and cares for his own.
Yes.
I must tell Jesus all of my troubles.
Yes.
For he is a kind, compassionate friend.
Yes, he is.
And if I but ask, he will deliver, make all my troubles quickly an end. I must tell Jesus.
Yes.
I must tell Jesus.
Yes.
I cannot bear these burdens alone.
Yeah.
I must tell Jesus.
Yes.
I must tell Jesus. For Jesus can help me.
Yeah.
Yes, Jesus alone.
Yeah.
God bless you on this morning. May it keep you. Put down your hands about the directors.